last letter of Paul, the very last letter he wrote when he is coming to the end of his own life and his own ministry, as you will recollect from chapter 4, verse 6, I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time of my departure has come. He is really saying that the end of his life is near and therefore the end of his ministry. And he is most eager to pass on the torch, as it were, to Timothy. This young man who has so many disqualifications that would disable him for the kind of ministry that he's going to have, taking up the apostles' ministry. But precisely this is what Paul is doing. He's handing over the baton, as it were, to Timothy. And therefore, he gives him some very serious instruction about what it means to be a servant of God in this particular age. And that particular age is actually very like our own age. An age of spiritual decline, an age of moral confusion, an age when the whole world seemed to be in chaos. And this is the very time at which Timothy is called into this particular ministry. Now, last Wednesday evening, we saw that Paul is urging Timothy that a life that is going to tell for God in such a world must be marked by three things, each of them illustrated by a different kind of person. The three things that need to mark the life of such a man of God as Paul prays Timothy may become are first, self-sacrifice, secondly, self-discipline, and thirdly, self-denial. And he sees these in three particular figures. The first is the figure of the soldier. You get it in verse 3, do you notice? Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer and so on. The person who illustrates for Paul self-discipline is the athlete, and you meet him in verse 5. Similarly, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not receive the victor's crown unless he competes according to the rules. That is, he disciplines himself to run within the rules, and Paul is speaking clearly about self-discipline. Finally, he sees self-denial illustrated in the farmer, who denies himself rest, for example, in the morning. You know the kind of thing that happens. He is roused early in the morning. He has to sacrifice the right to his time, for instance, because he is to do certain things at certain seasons. Above everything else, he is to engage in hard work. And the servant of God is to be marked by these things. Self-sacrifice, which he cheerfully takes up because he wants to please the one who is the captain of his army. We have the captain of our salvation, and our self-sacrifice is because the greatest prize, the greatest aim, the greatest goal, the ultimate ambition of life is to please him. Now, Paul says, you will need to be like that. You will need to have the self-discipline of the athlete who is ready to discipline his life for the sake of the gospel. You will need to have the kind of self-denial, the hard work of the farmer. And these Paul presses upon Timothy as essential elements in a servant of God. You would probably have thought, if you had been asked, if he is describing what it means to be a servant of God, well, he would need a brilliant mind. He would need various things like that that we tend to look for in candidates for the ministry, for example. And Paul says it's self-denial, self-sacrifice, and self-discipline that matter more than anything else to God. The whole theme could be summed up in Bishop Ryle's terse statement, "There are no gains without pains." And that is abundantly true in anything worthwhile for God which we do. Now, from verse 8 to verse 13, Paul goes on to take this same general theme a bit further and to press upon Timothy the truth that suffering and glory, trials and triumph, pruning and fruitfulness go together. Indeed, they are produced the one by the other. And again, you will notice, from verse 8 to verse 13, he has three illustrations of this principle. Three illustrations of the principle that suffering and glory go together. Not just that the suffering is an element in our experience and the glory is an element in our experience and the glory makes the suffering worthwhile, but rather that the suffering is what produces the glory. And this is what he means when, for example, in Romans 5, he says, tribulation produces endurance. And tribulation has an effect on our lives. I've frequently told you, I'm sure, about the missionary who, I think originally it may have been Amy Carmichael who wrote it up, how this missionary had been traveling in some jungle pathway, totally distraught. I think they had discovered some dreadful news from home and suddenly realized what it was to be thousands of miles away from home. They had been sick. They had known illness. They had gone through many trials. They had experienced what almost every missionary experiences when they go overseas, that they didn't get on with their fellow missionaries very well. Well, you're set down with people you had never chosen to live with, and the difficulties are many. And this particular missionary was walking through the jungle pathway, greatly distressed and distraught. And he saw on a branch a chrysalis of a butterfly. Going through all the trembling, shuddering, laboring that the chrysalis goes through before the butterfly escapes out of that shell, as it were. And the missionary looked at it and watched it, and it was shuddering and trembling. And then there would be a little bit of the butterfly that would suddenly appear, and then it would go back in again. And there was this awful sense of tribulation. And concerned for it, he put his hand in his pocket and took out his penknife and carefully slit up the chrysalis. And the butterfly flew away onto a branch, a poor, deformed, colorless creature. And he discovered that day that it was the tribulation which put glory into the thing. Now, that's the principle that Paul is teaching us. Tribulation produces glory. And these three areas from which he illustrates it are very simple, really. In verse 8, it is the experience of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. In verses 9 and 10, it's the experience of the Apostle Paul. And in verses 11 to 13, it's the experience of ordinary Christians like ourselves. So you notice how he develops this, and you can see it as we work our way through these verses. First, this pattern of glory through suffering is seen in the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Notice how he puts it. This is a rather unusual verse, this eighth verse. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel for which I am suffering. Now, Paul's command seems a strange command, first of all, doesn't it? When you come across this, remember Jesus Christ, he says. Now, writing to a Christian man like Timothy and to a servant of God, how in the wide world could you imagine that Timothy would forget Jesus Christ? So it seems a very strange thing if you look at it carefully. How can he be saying to Timothy, remember Jesus Christ? And yet, when you think of it, isn't that one of the things that God has had to say to his people again and again down through the whole of Scripture? For instance, let me read to you from Deuteronomy chapter 8, one of the great repeated words of Deuteronomy. I sometimes read them at a Remembrance Day service, for example, is this: be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commandments. Then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers. They were in grave danger of forgetting the Lord. And so he says, remember the Lord. And the epitaph that's written over Israel in their day of failure was, they forgot. Most of us at my age remember it in the Authorized Version, don't we? They forgot the Lord who saved them. Now, it's so easy. You say the Old Testament, just a moment. You remember Jesus before he died, when he instituted that supper and said to his disciples, do this in order to remember. Don't forget, he says, but remember me. And as he taught them to break the bread and pour out the wine and partake of it, he was saying, remember me. This is my body which is broken for you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood which was shed for many for the remission of sins. Do this to remember. Don't forget. And it's something that we need to bear in mind. Now, it's not just a case of amnesia or the geriatric condition that comes upon you, as you will discover, no matter how young you are this evening, believe me, that you keep forgetting things. It's actually forgetting the significance of what God is calling us to remember. Remember the Lord, he says. It is he who gave you the strength and energy to gather all these things. So when you're becoming a materialist and you're proud of all the things that you have earned and they've become your own, don't forget the Lord, he says, because it was the Lord who gave you the power to earn and to create wealth. And when you are inclined to remember Jesus even by name and to use his name a great deal, Jesus is saying, don't forget the central thing. This body of mine was broken for you. This blood of mine was poured out for you. So remember, do not forget. And Paul is saying, remember Jesus Christ. Now, that's an immensely important thing. And what he is really saying is, do not forget who Jesus Christ is, what he did for us, why he came, how he accomplished our salvation. These are the things that he wants us to remember. And so he encapsulates in this tiny little sentence of 9 words the whole gospel. You notice how he says, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel. Now that's rather remarkable, because you might well say, well, that's a pretty scaly account of the gospel if that's what Paul is telling us is his gospel. But if you notice, they are a remarkable summary, these few words, of Christ's person and his work. What is the gospel? The gospel is Christ, his person, who he was, and his work, what he has done. Now notice how Paul speaks of it, in his person. For these words speak of Christ's divinity. He was very God of very God. He was God in his person and nature. How do we know that? Well, we know it by the resurrection. He was publicly, powerfully declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. So he says, remember Jesus Christ raised from the dead. And the person of Jesus Christ is the person of one who is fully, utterly God, and it's the resurrection that powerfully declares that. But in his person, he is not only fully God, he is holy man. Now, how do we know that? Well, look at what Paul says. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. Now, why do you get all these genealogies at the beginning of Matthew's Gospel and Luke's Gospel, for example, when Jesus' lineage is traced back? What the New Testament is saying to us is, this is a real man. He has a genealogical history, like all of us. He has an ancestry. He is the son of David, as well as the son of God. Now, do you see why this is important? Let me just remind you. It is important because he came into the world to deal with our sin. That, incidentally, is why he was called Jesus. Do you notice? This is all shorthand, of course, you know. Remember Jesus Christ. You will call his name Jesus, said the angel. Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. Now, that leads us into the work that Christ did, you see. What did he come to do? He came to be a savior. He didn't just come to be an example of how God wanted us to live in the world. He came to deal with the ultimate problem of the human heart, which is our sin. But you will notice that the only one who could deal with our sin is God. Why is that? Well, our sins are not just an offense against our fellow human beings. Our sins are primarily an offense against God. David discovered that, you remember, in Psalm 51. Against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. He knew that it was against God that he had sinned. Now, who then can forgive sins? You remember the little discussion Jesus had with the paralytic man's friends and with the Jewish people who were gathered around? And he said to him, your sins are forgiven you. Oh, they said, blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Well, they were quite right. Only God could forgive sins. And this is why Jesus Christ had to be God in his nature in order to achieve the forgiveness of sins. But you see the other thing. He came to save his people from their sins by standing in our place, taking our position, sitting under the judgment of God on our behalf. And therefore, he had to be one of us. He had to be the last Adam, as Paul calls him, to be truly man as well as truly God, and to take our place and suffer for sins not his own. So he says, remember Jesus Christ raised from the dead, descended from David. Now, of course, he's speaking also, as I say, about his work. That's the person of Christ. The work of Christ is that he is the Savior of sinners. That is why he came, in order to bear our sin. And his resurrection, which Paul refers to, remember Jesus Christ raised from the dead, implies his death. So he is here speaking about both the death and the resurrection of Christ. And Paul says, this is my gospel, how he came and died, and how God raised him from the dead to triumph over sin and death and Satan, and by his resurrection he has done this, so that the glory of Christ's work is that he has wrought salvation for us and overcome sin and death and Satan. And this is the good news of the one who is both God and man, who came to take our guilt in our nature and was raised in triumph over sin and death and Satan. So this is what Paul means when he says, this is my gospel. But perhaps, indeed not perhaps, certainly, Paul's real concern is to lay emphasis, I think, on the fact that Jesus achieved salvation through suffering and agony and anguish. And it was through the anguish and suffering of the death of a sin bearer that he brought many sons to glory. What did we sing this evening about go labor on, spend and be spent? It is the way the master went. Should not the servant tread it still? And there is an abundance of truth in the fact that the Savior who suffered before he was crowned with glory is not just our substitute, he is our example. And that's why Paul cites the experience of Jesus. Now notice in verses 9 and 10, he cites his own experience. For which, for this gospel, I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. Now, there are only two places in the New Testament where that word for criminal occurs. And if I translated it a different way, you might be able to guess where that is. It really could be translated, I am suffering even to the point of being chained like a malefactor. Now, you know where we read about the malefactor, the man who was the penitent thief who was on the cross at the side of Jesus. He was a criminal. And that's where the word occurs outside of this particular chapter. And Paul is saying, I am suffering for the sake of the gospel like a criminal being chained. Now, notice the difference between Paul's suffering and our suffering, and Jesus' suffering. You notice there is a marked difference between Jesus' suffering and our suffering. Jesus' suffering may be an example to us to help us to endure our suffering, but the difference is that Jesus suffered in order that there might be a gospel to preach. We suffer, who are servants of Christ, to further the preaching of the gospel. That's the difference between Paul's suffering and Jesus' suffering. We must never imagine that our suffering has some redemptive effect in it. But our suffering is part of the ministry of the gospel, and God has set down this law that it is through great tribulation that we will enter in to the kingdom. You notice how Paul interprets his sufferings for us, which he does here. He says, "This is my gospel for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal." He relates it first of all to the Word of God and then to the people of God. Do you notice that? He says, "I am suffering even to the point of being chained like a criminal, but God's word is not chained." So he relates his suffering to the word of God. And what has happened in his imprisonment is that he has been brought into prison, but God's word, in some sense, has been liberated. The word of God, either he means he was preaching there in the prison house. You know, many people have said, wouldn't you have a little bit of sympathy for the soldier to whom Paul was chained? Day and night evangelism from the Apostle Paul for a pagan, and he was chained to him so he couldn't get away. Whether it was that or because he had some other opportunity, or just because at this particular point the word of God was being taken out by others into the community, the word of God does not suffer the kind of chains that Paul suffers. It is liberated. So there is a pattern in Paul's life that the word of God is liberated even through his suffering. There's another way of looking at that which interested me greatly. I was talking to somebody about this just yesterday afternoon in the vestry, as a matter of fact, and I was greatly interested that they had never even thought about that, somebody who doesn't preach. And I was saying to them, when they were talking about what it meant to preach and so on, I was saying to them, you know, there is a sense in which when somebody is going to discharge the task of ministering the word of God, the whole of that word and all its challenge and all its application has to be sent deeply into your own life, first of all. Because there's absolutely no point in just churning it out as though it was something that was akin to a lecture on literature or something of the sort. It needs to be plunged into the depths of your own being like the sword of the Spirit and to come out from there. John Stott once said in my hearing, "It's rather like giving birth twice every Sunday." No man can understand what that means, but some of you ladies may know what he meant. And the very pain and anguish that he was bearing freed the word of God, as it were. But you notice how he applies it not only to the word of God, this principle, but to the people of God. He says, therefore, therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that is God's chosen people, that they too may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Now, something very simple here. He says, I endure everything. That's everything that Paul went through in terms of the suffering and anguish of his own life. The care of all the churches, the physical hardship, the disasters that he had experienced, the fact that everybody now seems to have left and deserted him. You know that everyone, he says in verse 15 of chapter 1, in the province of Asia has deserted me, including Phygellus and Hermogenes, but he says, I endure it all for the sake of the people of God, that they too may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Now, the simple fact is that he is saying there is a price to be paid for blessing. In the Church of Jesus Christ, there is a price to be paid in bringing people into the kingdom of God. The service of Jesus Christ is a costly business. And it costs in all sorts of ways, as you will know. A Sunday school teacher said to me not long ago, on Saturday night, when I am preparing for Sunday school, I go through toils and anguish, blood, sweat, and tears for the sake of bringing the gospel to these children. Now, that's authentic service, my dear friends. Because there is a price to be paid in bringing people into the kingdom and bringing them on into maturity. And seeing them ultimately into eternal glory. Do you ever remember how Paul speaks about that? Isn't it in Galatians 4:19? My eye has just lit upon it. Galatians 4:19. Now here are the Galatians. You see, do you remember how he says to them, what on earth has happened to you? How did you manage to get away? You were running well. Who hindered you? And he's really distressed and disturbed about these people. Now listen how he speaks about them. What does he say? Does he say, well, I am going to come into the meeting place next week and really let you have a verbal lashing? No, he says, here's how it is, my dear children. Notice the introduction. My dear children, this is Galatians 4:19. For whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. Now, you will know that the production of physical life involves pain. And there are some pains in life that seem meaningless, pointless, without any significant explanation you can find. But there are other pains which are productive. And this language is not really theological. It's obstetrical. And he says, I am in travail until Christ is formed in you. But then he would have said to them, but I would gladly pay that price 1,000 times over if I see Christ formed in someone. So that's Paul's experience. The experience of Jesus, the experience of Paul, but now notice from verse 11 onwards, the ordinary Christian's experience. And this, if it is a hymn, I don't know whether it is, but it does contain four parts to it, four stanzas, as the musicians would say. They all begin with if, you know. If we died with him, we will also live with him. Death and life are bound together in the purpose of God. In Jesus' experience, in Paul's experience, in our experience, if we died with him, we will also live with him. Now that may mean that death we die when we are united to Jesus Christ, or it may be, as most New Testament writers seem to think, it may rather be dying to self. The kind of thing he's been speaking about in the soldier, the farmer, and the athlete. The death to self. If you're ready for that death, then life will spring out of the ground. You know how George Matheson wrote that hymn in which he speaks about death producing life. From the ground there blossoms red life that shall endless be. Now it's this that Paul is speaking about. There is a principle of death and life. If we endure, we will also reign with him. So it is the hard work of patient endurance that produces the crown of glory. Now there are two negative sides. These are two positive stanzas. The others are negative. If we disown him, he will also disown us. That's an almost direct quotation from Matthew 10:35, where Jesus says, "Whoever disowns me, I will disown him before my Father." And in verse 13, if we are faithless, he will remain faithful. Now, you would almost have expected something different in verse 13, wouldn't you? You would have expected if we are faithless, he will be faithless to us, to give us what we would call our own back. But the glorious thing about God is that he's incapable of being unfaithful to his promises. You know, the one thing God cannot do is to be unfaithful to his character. People sometimes ask, can't God do anything? If God is omnipotent, why can't he do anything? Well, he can do anything commensurate with himself and his own character, but he cannot deny himself and his own character, so he is faithful. But that doesn't mean that we can be unfaithful to him and we get off with it, as it were. That would be immoral of God. What it really means is that God never goes back on his word. Now that's something we do all the time, isn't it? We do it with promises. We say to children, or to one another, if you do this, I will give you this. And quite often, we either won't or don't do what we've promised. I'll tell you another thing you find people doing, making threats, especially parents to their children. If you do that again, I will do A, B, and C. Now, the child soon gets to know, are they faithful to their threats? Or do they deny themselves? And quite often the child will wait and see what happens, you know. And then the child knows very well that 9 times out of 10 the parent isn't going to fulfill the threat. The one thing you can be sure about with God is that he does everything he promises. And he does everything he threatens. And God is absolutely faithful to every word he speaks. Never is there an idle word escapes from the mouth of the Lord. Now that means, of course, you can trust him 100%. And you will know that if you are one of his children and you have been unfaithful to him, he'll pursue you to the ends of the earth to bring you back to him again. That's what he'll do. He will never give up on his purpose or his promise. And you can rely on his word. But it's true, you know, no gains without pains. And if God calls you to serve him, whatever it might be, then there's a price to be paid somewhere. And please God, we may be ready for costly service. Just one word and then I'm really done. It's just 20 past nine, so we're finishing on time. The one word is this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul talks to the Corinthians about two ways of building. He's talking about the kind of service that they will give to God. And he says, like a wise master builder, I laid the foundation, and others built on it. Now, he said, they build with, and then he goes through two different kinds of material: wood, hay, stubble, gold, silver, and precious stones. Now, you know the difference between these two groups of materials. One is cheap. Wood, hay, stubble, cheap. It's also temporary. Wood, hay, and stubble go up in a blaze, or they're swept away in a flood, or the wind knocks them down. They're temporary. Gold, silver, and precious stones are costly, not cheap. And they're permanent. They last. You put the fire underneath them, and you know all you do? You just purify them. And Paul says, now which are you building in the kingdom of God? Gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, stubble? May God make us good builders. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we do pray that you would write your word in our hearts and help us to learn and understand it, and above all to embrace it and let it sink deeply down into our lives. And bless us by your grace and lift our hearts up to you this evening, and help us to fix our hope in all that you are, for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.